If you ever use a debit card or a credit card, you need to watch this video till the very end. Welcome back, I'm the Black Belt Barrister helping you to understand law. So there are fundamental differences between a debit card and a credit card, many of which you may already be familiar with. At least in passing, you might have heard of them, but maybe not fully understand what they are. Hopefully in this video and by the end of this video, you will understand a little bit better what the differences are, which card you should use, and why? Starting out with some rather fascinating statistics. There was over £2 billion in debit and credit cards in the month of May alone. Figure was up, believe it or not, by 17% on May the year before. When it comes to contactless payments, these accounted for 60% of all credit card transactions and, believe it or not, 74% of debit card transactions. Remembering that there are different rules for contactless payments, both for debit cards and credit cards, which fundamentally hinge on the same underlying law, which I'm going to come back to in a moment. So naturally, I would think what most of you are most interested in is the protection that you get when using either of these cards. And so you may have heard of a Section 75 claim and that it offers some protection, but you may not know what it is, where it comes from, and how it works, and more importantly, which cards it applies to, which will fundamentally underscore which payment method I choose when I buy anything. Remembering, of course, that none of this video is financial or legal advice. So first of all, Section 75, what is it and how does it work? Section 75 of the Consumer Credit Act applies when you make a purchase when any of it is financed, so long as the purchase is for something between £100 and £30,000. So if you've paid for even some of this purchase, doesn't need to be all of it, but some of this purchase that's between £100 and £30,000, this is a really useful bit of legislation because it means that it engages Section 75 of the Consumer Credit Act. So Section 75 of the Consumer Credit Act states that if the debtor, i.e. you, making the purchase, in an agreement which is covered by this section in relation to a transaction which is financed by the agreement, any claim against the supplier, i.e. the supplier that sold you the goods or the services, in respect of a misrepresentation or breach of contract, he shall have a like claim against the creditor, who with the supplier shall accordingly be jointly and severally liable to the debtor. So what that means in plain English is if you buy a product or a service that's between £100 and £30,000 and any part of it is financed, either by a loan or a credit card or something like that, then Section 75 of the Consumer Credit Act is engaged. And what that means is that for any breach of contract or a misrepresentation, then you have an equal claim against the credit card provider or the credit provider, as you do against the trader that sold you the products or the services. So in the event that you ever need to sue and go to court for a breach of contract for a defective product or a defective service, it's not just the trader from whom that you purchased the goods or the services that you sue, it is also the credit provider, and it is joint and several liability. So the credit provider is jointly and severally liable in the contract. In other words, you sue them both. What very often, though not always, happens is that the credit provider will get in touch with the trader to tell them to sort it out, because clearly the credit provider now has a vested interest in making sure that the claim is dealt with expeditiously. So now moving to debit cards, what protection do you have with using a debit card for any of these payments? Well, because a debit card is not a credit facility as such, it doesn't engage Section 75 of the Consumer Credit Act. Instead, there is what's referred to as a chargeback scheme. You might have heard of chargebacks in relation to both debit and credit cards, and indeed many providers do run chargeback schemes for both debit and credit cards, but here's the fundamental difference. A chargeback, unlike a Section 75 claim, is not enforced by law. It is simply an in-house rule or scheme that the majority of card providers will run. But you really should check with your card provider if you're going to use a debit card as to how your provider runs this scheme. There's normally a time limit for bringing a chargeback, which is usually 120 days, after which the bank is probably going to reject it. And fundamentally, there will be lots of different rules that you will have to comply with if the bank is going to accept your chargeback request. One of the most common complaints that gets reported to me is that the bank complains that the person has been negligent. In other words, they've allowed somebody to take their PIN number, i.e. PIN surfing or skimming or something of that nature, or they've left the card lying around somewhere and then it's been used for contactless payments, and very often the banks say that they've been negligent and therefore not going to refund the money because as they say, if the cardholder has been negligent, the bank shouldn't be responsible. But in virtually all cases, they will open a dispute and fully investigate the matter before giving you a decision. If your chargeback claim fails and you really feel that it should have been upheld, you can take it to the Financial Ombudsman within 6 months of being notified that they've turned down your claim. So fundamentally, you can probably see the difference between debit cards and credit cards. Credit cards, because they use a form of credit, engage Section 75 of the Consumer Credit Act. Even if you only use it to pay a small amount of the contract, it still engages the Act and still makes the creditor jointly and severally liable to the contract. So the bottom line is, I'm sure you'll want to know, is that I do not use a debit card for anything. I use a credit card for virtually everything. But now you might ask about how this applies to PayPal, for example. Well, you need to think that PayPal is in the middle of you and the end purchase. Whilst PayPal will have their own rules, regulations, and methods of recalling payments, for which they've been fairly famous for, your bank is very often going to turn down a chargeback claim for any purchase that is made using PayPal when you've transferred the money into PayPal with your debit card. The simple reason is there's a break in the chain of causation. As far as the bank's concerned, your money has gone into PayPal and the bank has fulfilled its obligations. One or two other final bits to round off from Section 75 of the Consumer Credit Act is that it still applies even if you've exceeded the credit limit or otherwise contravened any other terms of your credit agreement, and if you bring an action against only the credit provider, they are entitled to bring the supplier into the proceedings as well. Doubtless and very often the credit company is going to blame the supplier because ultimately it will say that the supplier got it wrong. So I hope this video has been a useful overview. Please do like the video and subscribe, and as always, thank you for watching.